So I'm going to talk about the future of diagnosis and diagnostics, and I think, you know, we'll formalize many of the things that have already been said today. Take-home message, if you have to leave early, is every rare disease was once an undiagnosed disease. I think that take-home message has been loud and clear already. And a modest amount of funding for an unmet need continues to make a difference nationally and internationally, as I'm about to tell you. So I'm going to tell you about the NIH Undiagnosed Diseases Program. It came about in the beginning of, in the spring of 2008, but it was really as a result of the fact that in the Genetic and Rare Diseases Information Center, they were getting calls from patients with rare diseases, but 6% of the patients that called that office didn't have a diagnosis at all. They had been on this diagnostic odyssey for, as we've talked about, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years. For the adults, sometimes it was decades. So, and for those patients who did have a diagnosis, a third of them took up to 5 years to get one, and 15% of people took more than 5 years to get a diagnosis. So the program was launched in May. It was a pilot project at the National Institutes of Health at the clinical center that you see here. It really fulfilled two of the missions of the NIH, which were public service, to provide answers to patients with mysterious conditions that had eluded diagnosis for a long time, people that had been on the diagnostic odyssey, and to advance biomedical research. If we could find out new things, new diseases, new genes, and we could understand how they really worked in the body, we could probably apply those to more common diseases. So I'm going to tell you about that. So our working hypotheses when we brought in children and adults, this was about two-thirds adults, one-third children when we initially got started. And we sort of worked under the premise these were extremely rare diseases with just a little bit different phenotype, a little different presentation. They were an unusual presentation of a slightly more common disease. They were more than one disease, and that sometimes happens, or it was a brand new disease that no one had seen, similar to what Christina has been talking about today. So in the pilot phase of the program, we got about 3,500 inquiries. We went through, and I didn't put the photo in here, about 1,500 medical records. And when I talk about medical records, I mean medical records. About 500 patients were seen. About a third of them, as I said, were children. And we made a diagnosis in roughly 25 to a quarter to a third of the patients. Now, I will say this, that not all of the patients have genetic disease. I think for the patients that had genetic diseases, the hit rate was much higher. The hit rate is higher in children because most of the children really did have a genetic disease. We did this by using exome sequencing, and this was when exome was really in its infancy. When we started, there were no clinical laboratories that offered exome sequencing, so it was all done on a research basis. And actually, what I'm going to tell you, it's when all else fails, I say this to my residents, when all else fails, touch the patient. Really good evaluations of patients, and this is what these patients receive for a week inpatient admission at the NIH, where we had the time to sit down and read the records carefully, look at the patients in detail, and really think a lot about the patients. You know, I go to the doctor, you go to the doctor, and how many patients is that doctor going to see in a day? 20, 30, 40? They can't possibly do this. But for a rare subset of patients who don't have a diagnosis, it really takes the time, really the luxury of time, to sit and think about these patients carefully. And then to propose some targeted testing. So I told you that the pilot program went for 5 years. We were fortunate enough to receive funding then from the NIH Common Fund for the next phase of the program, which expanded it not just to the Bethesda campus, but to 6 clinical sites across the country. You can see them here, one of which is Duke that we've talked about. And not only were there clinical sites, there was a coordinating center at Harvard. There were 2 sequencing cores, one at Baylor and one at Hudson Alpha that was sponsored also by Illumina. And a biorepository. We had also a model organisms core where we could make animal models. If we found a new gene that had never been seen in disease before and asked the question, well, gosh, if you make, using gene editing technologies, if you make a mouse or if you make a zebrafish, does it look the same? Does it have the same phenotype? That's sort of how you prove that, yes, in fact, what you're seeing in the gene that you're seeing that's abnormal really does cause what you think it causes. We also have a metabolomics core that looks at other metabolites in blood, urine, skin, and so forth that will help us make the diagnosis. So this is the program that's currently going. Patients apply online themselves. They fill out some demographic information, and they upload a letter from their referring physician that basically details their history and says, you know, this is why we, this, here's what I've done to try and make a diagnosis. This is why it's still undiagnosed. Will you accept the patient into the program? And I can't see this very well from here, but this was the dashboard on the website as of Sunday that we had received, what, 1,900 applications, and I think we had accepted 800 or so patients. You can see the numbers better than I do. And the diagnoses at this point were about a third. Some of these diagnoses, when they turn out to be new diseases, take years to actually prove that, in fact, what you think is the problem actually is the problem. So many of these kids and adults are still in the process. Here's where the patients have come from. You can see where they go to the different sites and the different colors of the different sites. But roughly speaking, they follow the population base. We would be hopeful for another site, perhaps in the Midwest. That would be nice. The most important thing we've learned is that data sharing in a common language is really key. And what I mean by common language is when a clinician comes in and describes a patient, they don't often use exactly the same words as the next clinician does. Well, it's sort of like then comparing apples to oranges. If we use a common language, we call this the human phenotype ontology, we can actually then compare patients across the country, around the world, because we're using the same language. And through the Monarch Initiative, which was also NIH funded, the Monarch folks were able to actually take things that you describe in a patient, for example, a cleft lip, and call that something in a mouse model. Or if you had a flat face as a child, maybe that was a short snout if you were a mouse. And they've done this through a number of animal models so that we have a way to compare now even speaking the same language as we cross organisms, which has been very important in coming up with diagnoses. So we wanted to expand the program further. And so several years ago and five international meetings ago that were funded by the NIH through the Common Fund, we put together the Undiagnosed Diseases International Organization. You can see here that this now started out with the US and Italy and now involves 23 countries. And the whole point here is if you are one of only two or three people in the country that have a specific genetic change or a specific diagnosis, how do you find somebody else that has the same thing? And you do that by, well, one of the ways, a very good way that you do that is by using the Matchmaker Exchange, which is basically a series of funded sites, spokes in a wheel, that will talk to each other in a de-identified way. For example, I can put in my patient's phenotype, cleft lip, short stature, developmental delay, and a long list of terms, and my candidate gene, my gene variant is, I'm making this up, ABC6. And let's say someone else in Italy or, you know, the Netherlands has a similar phenotype and has found a change in that particular gene. Those will both go into the Matchmaker Exchange, and then it will notify in a de-identified way the people who actually put those in, and then they can start talking to each other. And this is the way we find second and third and fourth cases. In Christina's situation, they were very lucky, and they used actually what we also have begun to utilize, which is social media. And Matt, has been a ringleader in the Undiagnosed Disease Network at helping patients put up their own web pages. And so we now have about 40 of these on the Undiagnosed Disease Network website. No names, but if families put up information about themselves or their children, it is perfectly fine. I can't put up protected health information on a patient, but a family can certainly put it up on a patient. So social media has turned out to be a huge way that families link to each other and then link to scientists. Okay, so diagnostics. All of us, if you remember from 10th grade biology, learned the central dogma, DNA makes RNA makes protein, right? And that's true. So a lot of the assumptions we have going forward for genetics are if you have a mutation in the DNA, it creates a mutation in the RNA and creates an amino acid substitution in the protein, and so the protein doesn't fold right, and it either does a lot of damage because it's not folded right, or it doesn't work. Or you have a really bad mutation that basically eliminates the RNA itself and eliminates the protein, and so now you have nothing. But it's more complex than that, really, because beyond the central dogma, there are a number of things that are feeding into this, and this is sort of the end of the 21st century, I guess, piece, which would be epigenetic factors, things that are influencing the DNA that are within the cell that actually modify gene expression in particular patients, or Environmental exposures. Part of the Undiagnosed Disease Network, families fill out an environmental exposure questionnaire. And you can imagine, particularly for some of our vets, they've been exposed to some pretty horrendous things, and that's going to play havoc with some of the things in their DNA. So environmental exposures are important. They're going to help us. Predisposing mutations. Most people have heard about the predisposing mutations for breast cancer, but there are plenty of others for autoimmune diseases and things that if you have the gene, it doesn't mean you're absolutely going to get the condition, but it means you're going to have a higher chance to get the condition than somebody else. So those predisposing factors, tissue-specific expression, RNA, I mean, all cells have the same DNA, but obviously a skin cell and a muscle cell or a neuron don't express the genes in the same way. So what controls that, what modifies that, you know, we're at, especially for the brain, we're really at the beginning of understanding some of this. And then infections or predisposition to infections. We have launched in the NIH huge studies on the microbiome, those organisms that live on your skin and that we don't think about all the time, but they probably also play a role in health and disease. So the rare informs the common. I think I'm reiterating what some of our other speakers have said, and I'm going to give you two examples of why it's important to study rare diseases. The first was the discovery of the low-density lipoprotein receptor by Goldstein and Brown in the mid-80s. This was the scenario that there was an exceedingly rare, like we're talking 1 in 1 million, familial hypercholesterolemia, a recessive disease in young children where they would get these huge cholesterol deposits on their joints and they would have heart attacks in their teens and early 20s and they would all die. And from that, Brown and Goldstein were ever able to discover the LDL receptor and the fact that it was LDL cholesterol for those of us who are on bad diets that was really the problem and really has helped to mitigate a lot of heart disease, which obviously is one of the more common maladies in this country, and help in the discovery of statins. How many people are on statins or know somebody who's on a statin? Like all of us, right? So a very rare disease helped launch a lot of therapy for very common diseases. A more recent link, a colleague of mine, Ellen Sidransky at the Genome Institute, has a collection of patients with Gaucher disease. It's the most common lysosomal storage disease. It's a rare disease, but it's not super rare. But she started noticing that there were a lot of people in the extended families who were carriers for this who had early onset Parkinson's disease. So as a result of that observation, she began an international collaborative. That collaborative has absolutely documented that now the most common risk factor for the development of Parkinson's disease is to be a carrier for Gaucher disease. So, you know, what is it about being a carrier for Gaucher disease that predisposes you to Parkinson? That's the million-dollar question, so we're still working on that piece. But, you know, so really the rare informs the common. That's been true in the Undiagnosed Disease Network. It's been true sort of globally. And last but not least, as has already been said, rare diseases are rare individually, but collectively they're pretty darn common. I'm using the conservative estimate, not the NORD estimate, on the U.S. population, 6 to 8%. Some people would say up to 10% of patients, people have a rare disease. Okay, so if you're a child and you have a couple of parents and a few grandparents, that's, or if you're an adult and you have a spouse and you have some siblings, you know, I would say conservatively, every person with a rare disease knows at least, has at least 3.5 first-degree relatives who you know, has first-degree relatives. So really, when you think about it, a quarter of us either have a rare disease or know someone, a first-degree relative in their family who have a rare disease. So these diseases are not rare, and in many cases, they're going to be the key to treating common diseases. So thanks for your time.